your name. We magnify 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 your name. Lord, you're wonderful. Lord, we love you tonight. We love you tonight, Lord. 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 We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. We take our time tonight to glorify you. We take our time tonight to magnify you. We take our time tonight to love on you. You've been so good to us, God. We don't have enough time to give you, God, but we take this time tonight, Lord, to glorify your name. We take this time tonight, Lord, to magnify your name. We worship him. We worship him. We worship him. We worship him. We worship you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. We worship you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
We worship you in spirit and in truth. We open our hearts to you tonight, Lord.
Yes, God.
We open our hearts to you tonight, Lord. And we say, Father, have your way. Speak to us tonight. We need you, Lord, more than we need our next breath. Father, we need you tonight. We ask you to move in this place. We ask you, Lord, to let your glory be revealed, God. Lift up the bow down head tonight. Father, save, deliver, and set free, God. Father, we want you to get the glory. That's our ultimate goal tonight, God, is that you get the glory out of everything that's said and everything that's done in this place on tonight. So we bless you, God. We praise you, and we honor you in Jesus' name. Come on and clap your hands and give the Lord some praise. Hallelujah. We glorify him. We honor him and we magnify his name because there is nobody like the Lord. There's nobody like the Lord. I don't care what you're going through. Hallelujah. If you know God, you know that it's going to be all right. I don't care what your circumstances are saying to you, regardless to what it looks like. If you know the Lord, you know that everything is going to be all right because greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. So we got to pull on our strength tonight and believe that God is God all by himself and it's going to be all right. Look at somebody and tell them, it's going to be all right. Hallelujah. Let's receive our apostle tonight. We're in for a treat. That's right. Put your hands together for him. We're in for a treat tonight. Been blessing us all week, every week with his teaching that the Lord has blessed him to give us. So we praise the Lord for you tonight, Apostle, and we say, let the Lord have his way. Come on, point to the man of God and say, let the Lord have his way. Come on, let's receive our Apostle. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Come on, continue to praise the Lord. 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 Amen, amen. Come on, somebody just open up your mouth and just say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Come on, tell them hallelujah. Tell the Lord hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. God is good. Somebody say we're working on winning.
We're working on winning.
That's right. We're working on winning. You can have your seats in the house of God on tonight. Amen. We're so happy and ecstatic to be back here one more Wednesday night to be able to share what thus saith the Lord. God is with us. He's helping us and he's strengthening us in these hours and these moments. And I believe that he has something great in store for us on tonight. Amen. Is anybody a winner? Do you know you're a winner? Do you know you're a winner? Do you know you're a winner? Somebody just shout, I am winning.
I am winning.
You're winning. Why are you winning? Because God has anointed you. He has ordained you. He has called you to have victory. Amen.
Yeah.
He has called you to have victory. I am victorious because of him. Because of him. I can't do it in my own strength. I can't do things on my own. When I try to do it on my own, my strength runs out. Does anybody's strength ever run out?
Yes.
Your strength runs out, your ability to do certain things, it runs out, the ability to do things certain ways, it runs out. But when you get to the place where you know that God is with you, and you know that God is having his way for you, and yeah. in you, and by you, and through you,
yeah.
that's when you know that you can win in spite of. Somebody just tell your neighbor, I'm winning in spite of. You're winning in spite of. So just for a quick catch up, we're going to just pop through a few of these slides just so everybody can catch up. Those who may be first time viewing this particular teaching that we are in, though those who may be a first time being in the sanctuary with us on tonight and you did not get any of this these teachings so far. So our base scripture on this working on winning campaign that we are in is 2 Corinthians chapter number 2. Verses, I believe, 12 through 14. 2 Corinthians chapter number 2, verses 12 through 14. So I'll let you guys grab your word on tonight, and then come on and get that on tonight. 2 Corinthians chapter number 2. 2 Corinthians chapter number 2. Excuse me. You can tell when the weather starts changing. Is that right? Amen. But God is still with us. Somebody said, we victorious even over the weather. That's right. We're victorious over the weather. Why? Because we're able to do some things. We're able to continue to move on, you know, and we're able to do and make our way to the house of God. And anytime when the weather becomes adverse, you know, we try to make allowances for certain things and everything, but we still know that God is with us and he'll help us, because I believe there's strength in the house of the Lord. Does anybody believe that besides me, that there's strength in the house of the Lord? Amen. Somebody just say, it's strength in here. This is why it's so important as we're winning, as we are desiring to have a winning attitude and a winning mindset, we also must have a winning vocabulary. This is why you just can't allow yourself to just say anything as a believer. Anything just can't come out of your mouth. You can't just, you know, and I'm telling you, y'all hands and y'all, you know, the thoughts. Now, there's one thing to have a thought. You know, somebody says one thing to have a thought. But it's another thing to say what you're thinking. But the problem is, some of us say, well, I ain't saying what I'm thinking. But many of us, we are typing what we are thinking. We're typing what we are thinking. We allow Facebook to get us in trouble. We allow, you know, text messages to get us in trouble. We allow Twitter to get us in trouble. And some of us, we allow the camera on our phone to get us in trouble. Is that right? Because we were thinking something, and then so we took a picture of it, and then we said something that we shouldn't have said with the picture. Anybody ever heard the picture's worth of what? 1,000 words. A picture's worth 1,000 words. So you just can't put everything that you put on, and then, you know, you say, man, I look this way. But now when you put it on and you feel like you look this way, but then when you take the picture and then you populate it for a society to look at you, now you have put yourself from the place where you was winning privately, now you're losing publicly. Anybody ever seen that? Yeah, come on, y'all can be honest in here. You know, I know. Maybe you might be the one that took the picture. So, but have you ever seen somebody a picture? You say, what in the world was they thinking about putting this picture on Facebook? Yeah, What was they thinking about putting this on Instagram? What were they thinking tweeting this out? Anybody ever seen somebody? You saw the picture. You said that. You said, what was they thinking?
Yeah.
You have the option there. You have the option as to put it up there or not to put it up there. Just because it's in your phone don't mean that it has to go to the world.
That's right.
It's right. Some of the stuff that's in my phone, the only way it's going to go to the world is if my phone is hacked. But I ain't got nothing in my phone that can't be hacked. So if it is hacked, it still ain't going to come back, and you ain't going to be able to say, what was I thinking? Because I'm trying to win in every environment that I'm living in. I'm trying to win in all of these areas. So 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse number 12 through 14. Everybody got it?
Yes.
All right, it says, let's read it together. It says, furthermore, when I came to Troas to preach, Christ's gospel, and a door was opened unto me of the Lord. I had no rest in my spirit, because I had found not Titus, my brother, but taking my leave of them, I went from thence into Macedonia. Now thanks be unto God, which always causes us to triumph in Christ, and maketh manifest the savor of his knowledge by us in every place. So now this scripture tells us that the Apostle Paul, he's on a journey, he's on a mission, and as he's on a mission, he comes into a place, the door is open for him, he begins to preach, but he still had no rest because he could not find his colleagues, but he still said, I'm not going to allow what I can't find to prevent me from what I will discover. As a winner, you cannot allow what you can't find to prevent you from what you should and what you can discover. So even through the trials that you go through in your life, you will discover some things about yourself. Somebody say, I'm learning some stuff. You're learning some things. See, the problems and situations that come upon us, they come for us to be able to learn. They don't come for us to be encapsulated or to put into a crypt. They're not there to make us stay in a grave. They're not there to just make us to have to live in that place forever. But they are there for us to learn how to resurrect. Somebody say, I'm learning how to resurrect. You're going to learn. See, as a winner, you learn how to resurrect. You learn how to bounce back. You learn how to come through. But it is a work in progress. Minister Gary, let's go to the next slide here. We learn how to resurrect. So teamwork will help us to learn how to resurrect. Is anybody in here weak in any area? Oh, look, you got crickets because there's all the perfect people. So all the perfect people are in the house tonight, Pastor Gina. All the perfect people are in the house. But if you know you're not perfect, somebody just say, I'm not perfect. All right, so you're not perfect. So when in the area that you are not perfect in, you need someone to come alongside of you to help you to be perfected in that area. If you don't know how to cook, you need to go and find somebody that can teach you how to season your food. You need somebody to help you not to burn the water. You need somebody to help you not to scorch the pan all of the time. You need somebody to help you. Somebody say, Lord, send me a team. You need the Lord to send you a team that's going to be able to help you to reach the goal that you are called to go in. But when you try to isolate, and one of the things that the enemy loves to do is to try to make you feel like you are supposed to be isolated and all alone. But that's not what God is saying. Now, there's a difference between consecration and isolation. Somebody say, winners consecrate. Losers isolate. Ah, yes. Winners consecrate. When you consecrate, even when you are consecrating, you are not by yourself because you are going to talk to God. You're going to talk to God. But so many people, they say that they're consecrating, but what they're really doing is isolating because they don't want to face their problem. They don't want to face their circumstance. They don't want to face their situation. And when they don't want to face it, what begins to happen is you go into isolation mode. And now the enemy thinks he has you where he wants you to be. He thinks he has you in a place where you will not be able to come through, but God is saying, the team is going to help me reach my goal. The team is going to help you to reach the goal that God has before you. The team is going to help you reach the goal that you are supposed to reach. You are going to get there. Somebody shout, I'm going to get there. All right, let's go to the next slide. Minister Gary. Let's see here now. You go past the teamwork part, but now that when you are starting to achieve some victories, you cannot allow your head to swell. You cannot allow yourself to get beside yourself because you got on first base. Somebody say first base, but no run scored. First base, but no run scored. What does that mean? You have made some progress, but you have not got on the board yet. You have made some progress. Now, it's true that you cannot score if you never get on first base, but how many people have been stranded in a position in your life? How many have you been stranded? You've made some progress, but you have only made some, not all. Somebody, is that true in here? Is that true? You made some progress in some things, but you got stranded on base. You got stranded in some particular places. You got stranded in some particular mindsets. You got stranded in some particular areas of your life. But God is saying that what I want you to do is not get stranded, because it says here very clearly, it says, when you're winning, you keep working like you're losing. When you are winning things in your life, when you have made it to first base, you're going to act like you're still in the dugout. You're going to act like you have not, that you're still at the plate. You're going to act like you're going to, you know, that you are still trying to get somewhere. So somebody said, don't rest on your laurels. You cannot rest on your laurels. So the Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 12, he helps us to understand that. Now he says in verse 12, he says, the Lord, a door was opened unto me by the Lord to preach Christ's gospel. Now he's happy. Now many people, they get happy because they have a door that's been opened to preach. But they forget about that there are other people that are on the team that are not being, that are not getting the opportunity to forward Christ's gospel. Now Paul is looking at, he's looking at this, he's saying, yes, the door is open for me here, but where's Titus? Somebody said, where's my brother? You got to start looking at things. Part of being a winner, you don't want to just win alone. True winners don't want to win alone. True winners want to be able to see everybody win. Somebody just say, this is the no hate zone. This is the no hate zone. This is the place where I'm not going to be upset because you was able to accomplish some things in your life. I'm not going to be upset with you because you got blessed. I'm not going to be upset with you. There's no rivalry. There is no Cain and no Abel here. There is no Jacob and no Esau here. There is no Ishmael and Isaac situations going on. But I'm going to take you up with me. Somebody said, when he scores, we will all score. Y'all believe that tonight? When you score, I score. When I score, you score. When you come up, I'm coming up. Is that right? Come on, do I have any winners that believe like that? Somebody just tell your neighbor, we ain't going to be selfish with the blessing. So you're not going to be selfish with the blessing. So Paul is looking at the situation. He said, man, this is not right. But then even in all of that, he still comes back to the place of knowing that thanks be unto God, which is causing us to triumph. Somebody shout one more time. Say, I got victory.
I got victory.
Go to the next one, Reverend. All right, but victory is a choice. Victory is a choice. How many people are going to heaven, but they are losing in life? How many people are, they know they say, they know they speak in more tongues than everybody. They got more tongues than the UN, right? But the problem is they're losing in life because they have an attitude of only being able to win spiritually. They have an attitude that they only can win spiritually. So some pastors can only win the only way that they feel like they're winning is if they have an engagement to preach at every week. The only way that they feel like they're winning is if they can hoop and they can holler. The only way they feel that they're winning, if they feel like, you know, they get depressed because certain things may not be going their way. But you and I, as the believer, we have to choose to have the winning attitude. We have to choose to have the winning attitude. How the word tells us, he said, who believes the report? Who's going to believe our report? Joshua said when he got down to the end of his life and he started talking about saying, as for me and my house, we will do what? Serve the Lord. So because Joshua ran down this whole litany, he ran down this whole history of what was going on and even prophesied the potential of what could begin to happen. But he said, he made a declaration. Somebody shout, winners have to declare. As a winner, you've got to begin to declare some things concerning your life and your future by faith. So Joshua says, as for me and my house, what they're going to do, we will serve the Lord. So because Joshua already had, what's the story of Joshua? Who knows the story of Joshua? The story of Joshua is simply this. He was a servant of Moses. As Joshua being the servant of Moses, he saw Moses go through all of these different things, all the way to get to the point where Moses did not make it into the promised land. He saw Moses die on the mountain, and his body had to be hid. So Joshua saw, and Joshua had the spirit of Moses, but then he also said, I'm not going to allow this particular part of Moses' spirit to contaminate me from going forward in my blessing. So he chose to have a winning attitude. Now, what did Moses do when Moses came down the mountain the first time with some tablets? He got upset, right? Did he get upset and then he broke them, right? How many of us are breaking things that are supposed to be the law in our life? How many of us are breaking what's supposed to be the law? What is supposed to be the law for your life? I ain't supposed to have a bad attitude. But how many of us, once something happens, we get a real bad attitude and we have to tell everybody about themselves? Oh, Lord. Amen, light bulbs. I talk to the light bulbs. JBL speaker. How many people have you, JBL speaker, have you seen get upset because they didn't get their way? Let me talk to the other JBL speaker. JBL speaker over here on the left side. How many people have you seen that go out and get drunk because somebody made them mad? Oh, let's talk to the poll here. Mr. Poll, how many people have you seen that said they got upset and so now they gonna quit their job and they ain't got no other place to go? Light bulb over here, let me talk to you. How many people said, man, you know, I had a real bad day, so I need something that's going to make me happy. So let me go to the corner and grab me a package so I can fill up that black and mild with some skunk. That's a winning attitude or a losing attitude?
Losing
attitudes. But when we are people who say, I'm not going to break the law against myself because somebody else tried to provoke me into losing. Winners always have the potential of being provoked into losing. But it's a choice. It's a choice about what you do with your attitude. When you are presented with the option of slapping somebody's head off and making it roll down the aisle like a cabbage, when you're presented with that option, are you going to slap them beside the head or are you going to put your hand in your pocket and just say, you know, thank you, Jesus? Have you ever had to go give yourself a timeout? You have to go sit in the corner. You know how we got kids, you get kids timeouts. I know some of y'all still beating kids. So, you know, but some parents go and give their kids and say, you go sit over in the corner. And for how many other minutes that child is old, years the child is old, they're supposed to sit in the corner for that amount of time. They put them in the corner. So if the child is 4 years old, they put them in the corner for 4 minutes to teach them some discipline and help them to get some winning attitudes. But some of y'all don't have no self-control. So that's why you can fly off the handle so easy. Ooh, God. Nobody know. Pastor Gina, will you talk to me? Wait, you better talk to me because you're driving with me tonight. Come on. So now part of the situation is we don't have no self-control. So I just got to say what I got to say. I just got to type what I got to type. I just got to do what I got to do. Choose what? A winning attitude. When you choose you this day, who you going to serve, you will start making some seed into your future. When you choose how you're going to live and what you're going to do, this is how you change your whole perspective. Because the perspective is that your whole situation may never change, but how you view it will change based on the attitude you choose to go towards it. This is why David can say, I can sit in the middle of my enemies. I can sit there. God has prepared me a table. Somebody don't want to eat. Somebody say, now I'm going on a diet when it comes down to trouble. Anybody ever felt like say you're gonna go on a diet? But you want to be anointed, right? Come on, anybody here want to be anointed?
Come on, do you want to be used by God? Yes. Come on, you want to do some major things. Somebody, you know, how many people you heard people? I got some major stuff to do for the Lord. But they never want to sit in the table in the presence of their enemies. Because they can't stand to be around nobody. How can you do major things for the Lord and not be around nobody? Because part of doing major things for the Lord means that you are changing many people's lives. If you ain't changing nobody's life, you ain't doing nothing major for the Lord.
All right.
Is that right?
That's right.
What is it that you can do major for the Lord without affecting somebody else's life? Come on, somebody talk to me here. What can you do anything major for the Lord without changing somebody's life?
No.
Okay, reread. Get John chapter 3 for me. John chapter 3. Let's see what John chapter 3 says. You can do nothing major for the Lord without having a winning attitude. You ain't doing it for the Lord with a losing attitude.
All right.
John chapter 3, verse 16. John chapter 3, verse 16 and 17. Some of these preachers shouldn't even have to get their Bible out. What's wrong with y'all preachers tonight? Hold on. Wait for me. Y'all got it? We all going to say it together now, because I don't want nobody messing up. So if y'all ain't got it, y'all better get your Bible, get your smartphone, Apple, whatever. Y'all got it? Everybody got it? Say amen.
Amen.
All right, let's all read it together. 1, 2, 3, read. Right?
That whosoever believeth in him
shall
not perish but have everlasting life.
Okay. So hold, stop right there. Okay, so for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, so that what? Whosoever believeth in him should not what?
Perish.
So whosoever believe. So God chose to have a winning attitude towards your mess. So why is it that you can't have a winning attitude towards somebody else's mess? God had a winning attitude towards all of the stuff that, come on, now, you know, we want to come and go around this room. Because either four people disown me or people deleted their page or whatever, I've got 4,996 Facebook friends right now. And I've got about 900 more people that's following me right now, okay? And so now, and we went around all those 5,700 people, plus the people that are in here. I believe that each and every one of us have a story of what God has done for them, that forgave them. So see, there's some stuff that each one of us have done that we don't even know about, that the next person don't even know about, right? Mm-hmm. Deborah, do I know all your sin? She's like, oh, Lord, I hope not. Okay, I don't even know all of my wife's sin from when she was born up until the day she met me, and even after she met me. I don't know all of the things that she has done wrong. Yeah, but God knows, and God still chose to have a winning attitude towards your mess. Is God using you to still preach, Pastor Jenny? In spite of all your wickedness, in spite of all your evilness, in spite of all your mess that you have done, come on, is he using anybody else in here? Is he using you in your life in spite of everything you have done?
Yes, Lord.
Because so God did what? Chose to have a winning attitude towards you. Because if he didn't choose to have a winning attitude, he would say, you know what, I'm just going to let these people stay down on this earth, kill each other, and go to hell. But he said, I'm not going to do that. So why are y'all telling people to go to hell? Somebody said, we're going to win. Riri, they don't like me tonight. So I know, Riri, I know you love me. So you're going to talk to me, because we finna get you hooked up real good, right? All right, so come on here now. Understand. Choosing to win in that. So go to the next slide, Grim. This one right here just clearly said, winners focus on winning and losers focus on winners. What are you looking at? Ask your neighbor, what are you looking at? What have you been looking at? Are you looking at your goal, or are you looking at somebody else trying to block you from your goal? Because if you look at your goal, nobody can stop you from getting there anyway. As long as you look at what you're supposed to be looking at, you will get to where you need to get to. But as long as you're looking at somebody else and wondering what they're thinking about what you're going to do, stop needing somebody to like your status. You don't need nobody to like your status in order for you to get to your goal. Is that right? Remember, isolation versus consecration.
When you're consecrated, you'll get to your goal. Because God will send somebody to earmark you and say, here, we're finna anoint you for your goal. There's this man in the Bible that's flawed and all, named David, right? David was consecrated out there in the wilderness, right? He was consecrated out there with his daddy's sheep, right? Doing what he had to do, right? Singing melodies and songs to the Lord. Doing what he had to do, saying, I don't mind waiting, singing all those got a good sound of songs, penning all those psalms, doing everything that he had to do. And then somebody named Samuel that came to Jesse, his father's house, right? As Jesse comes to his father's house, David don't know nothing about it because David is only focused on worshiping the Lord, doing the job that he has set, having a winning attitude, not concerning himself that he got to walk through sheep dung, not concerning himself that he's got to, somebody say, I got to put up with somebody else's mess. You got to learn how to put up with somebody else's mess to get to where you got to go. You got to learn how to be willing to deal with some people's issues and not make them your own. See, because when you start getting all upset and aggravated and everything, that means now you're taking ownership of somebody else's issues instead of dealing with your own mess. Ain't that something? But so now God is saying that now David is dealing with the sheep. David is dealing with his father's stuff. He's dealing with all of these different things. And as he's dealing with these different things, God is already providing him the winning place that he's going to reside in. So if you start living in the aspect of saying, God, I'm going to do what's in front of me with the right attitude. And I'm going to do what I'm supposed to do with the right mindset. Then God sends Samuel onto Jesse's house. Samuel is looking through everybody else. And he says, surely there's somebody else here that you ain't telling me about. So you can't worry about who's trying to block you. What you supposed to be worried about? Doing the job that's in front of you. Doing the best thing that you're supposed to do that's in front of you. And as you're doing with the best that you have, the best that you can with what you have, the next thing you know, there's going to be a call. So what's your name? Whatever your name is, just holler your name to the top of your lungs.
Gary.
Come on, y'all in church don't act like y'all scared. Come on, holler your name to the top of your lungs. 1, 2, 3, holler your name.
Yeah.
Did you hear somebody call you? You called yourself. How could you not hear somebody call you? Come on, do it again. 1, 2, 3, call your own name. Did you hear your name being called? Did you hear your name being called?
Yes.
Did you hear your name being called? Yes. Did you hear your name being called, Walls?
Yes.
When you hear your name being called, that's synonymous that God is getting ready to have someone to call you a name, to pull you from out of the position that you're in, to be able to place you in the position that you're ordained for. When you are positioned in the place that you are ordained for, it often starts when you're working as a winner in another place. If you can work as a winner in another place, God said, oh, I can trust him. Oh, God, I can trust her. Oh, God, I can trust them to be able to do that. And when you start doing that, the next thing you know, come on, 1, 2, 3, call your own name again.
Right.
When you call your own name, now God is saying, I'm getting ready to tap you for your future. Somebody say, my future is getting tapped in.
My future is getting tapped in.
You're getting ready to tap into your future. You're getting ready to tap into your future. But so this is why you got to start calling your own name. You got to start calling your own name. Start becoming your own press writer instead of always giving press to somebody who's not doing something for you. How many times do you talk about the sporting guys? How many times do you talk about what's going on the reality show? How many times do you talk about how much press has Donald Trump gotten in this year? In these last 2 years, everybody, what Donald Trump did, how many people talking about what Hillary Clinton did, but everybody's down with what Hillary Clinton is doing, while everybody's down with what Donald Trump is doing, I have the question to ask you, what are you doing concerning your own life? Because they have already done some things to get to that place, to where they're being talked about. Somebody said, I got to get my focus off them. So you got to get your focus off the politics and start getting your focus and priorities on what you are supposed to be doing. If you don't like what the president is doing, why aren't you educating yourself and getting to the place where you can run for president?
Right.
Wow. If you don't like what the pastor's doing, why aren't you educating yourself and getting to the place where you can become a bishop? Aren't you getting yourself to the place where you can become the bishop? Because it's easier to have a losing attitude and focus on see, now this guy is looking at Michael Phelps and he said, oh man, see, Michael Phelps, he ain't even stroking right. But where's Michael Phelps? Is Michael Phelps ahead of him or behind him? So most times people who lose, they're always hating on somebody that's in front of them and not training for their own stuff. Next slide, Gary. I'm gonna just let that marinate. Okay, let's go real quick here. That's an elevator, right? Mm-hmm. That's an elevator, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so an elevator. Okay, so you. Then what's an elevator? Three walls, right? And a door that's going to close, right? Mm-hmm. Go to the next slide, Gary. What are these? Stairs, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, so you see a bunch of stairs. Go back one more time. We're moving real quick here now. So in this elevator, there's what? Three walls and a door that's going to close, right? Somebody say three walls. And the door that's going to close. Go to the next slide, please. What you see up here? Bunch of stairs, right? Okay, but what? Is this the only thing that you see that's there? What else do you see?
Trees.
Oh, say it again, Carol.
Trees.
You see trees. What else you see?
Mailboxes.
You see mailboxes. What else you see? Signs, right? Okay, so you see stuff that's elevating, right? Okay, so go to the next slide real quick, please. This ugly dude right here, forget him, but look behind the bald head ugly dude. Okay, so behind the bald head ugly dude, what do you see?
The sky.
Did you say the sky's the limit? Oh, thank you, Riri. Okay, so the sky's the limit. So you see the sky, you see the horizon, you see the skyline, right? Okay, can you go back two, please, one more time? One more. What's he here now? Tell me, are we doing quick quiz? What is it again? Three walls and a door. Go one more up. What you see there? Stairs and what else? Stairs, trees, elevation, signs, all the other kind of stuff. Last slide, please. Beside the bald head dude.
The sky, the grass.
The sky, the elevation. The end result. And you can look down on where you was at. But the point is that I want to make about that. The point is, there is no view from inside the elevator. There's no view from inside the elevator. Yeah, you may get up there a little quicker, but you didn't enjoy the view. That was in the elevator. Winners sometimes need to learn how to enjoy the view on the journey of where you're going. You have to learn how to enjoy the view where you're going. Where are you going? Where are you going? What is it that you're called to do? Do you just expect to get there overnight? And when you don't get there overnight, you wake up the next morning mad because you ain't there overnight? One of my good friends, Pastor Paxton Collins, he inspires me greatly. He inspires me greatly because this is a man who pastors a church. He works a job. He works with homeless people. He works with different people all day and all night. And then he goes home and he loves on his wife. He cooks for his wife. He does different things. He had an unfortunate incident that happened in his life where he had to adopt his nieces and his nephews. He takes care of many other people. He does all of these different things. But then he wanted to go to school and get some things done with his degree and some psychology. And so there have been times that we have been out. And as we were out, he said, man, everything's good. I'm going to go home and I'm going to go write my paper at 2 o'clock and 3 o'clock in the morning. I'm going to go and write a paper at 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock in the morning. Now, he's around the same age that I am. He has a career already, right? He's already doing some things. But he said, you know what? There's some more greater things that I need and I want to do. And but I can't take off of work and quit my job because of the age that I am, because of things I've already got going on in my life. So he said, I'm not going to quit my job, but I'm going to take the stairs to get to the place of elevation. So he signed up for classes. And guess what he did? A couple of months ago, graduated. Got his degree
in psychology. Got his degree, all because he said, I'm not going to try to take the quick route, because I can't take the quick route. I can't get into these three walls and this door that's going to close. So they can't stop me from elevating. Somebody say the view. Can't intimidate me from my end result. You cannot allow it to intimidate you from your end result. But the thing, in order to help you to get to that place, go to the next slide, Gary. We got to get rid of a complaining spirit. What do you see on the screen now?
Rain.
You see rain? Huh. You see the storm, huh? Okay, so, but in order to overcome a storm, we got to get rid of a complaining spirit. Just for the sake of time, I'm going to read, and you can write down in your notes, Philippians chapter 2, verses 12 through 16. Philippians chapter 2, verses 12 through 16. The word of God reads in Philippians chapter 2, verses 12 through 16. It says, wherefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do good of his good pleasure. Do all things what? Without murmurings and disputings, that you may be what? Blameless and harmless, the sons of God, without rebuke, in the midst of a crooked and a perverse nation, among whom you shine as what? Lights in the world, holding forth the word of life, that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run in vain, neither labored in vain. So understanding, as part of being a winner, when you are faced with a rain-soaked situation, when you are soaked with issues and abundance of cares and different things that are going on in your life, yes, you may talk about it. Yes, but you're talking about it to come up with a strategy to overcome it. Not to talk about it, to murmur and complain about it. See, whatever it is that you're facing, now look here again. What y'all say on the screen? Rain. Rain is on the screen. Rain is going on in your life. Rain is happening and is coming to try to soak you. Rain is coming and trying to deluge you. Rain is coming to try to overwhelm you. Rain is even coming to eventually try to sweep you away. But when you have a complaining spirit, you will never get out of the rain. As long as you have a complaining spirit, you will always be sitting there being soaked in and crying, man, I wish somebody would come and rescue me. God is saying, what I'm trying to get the believers to begin to do is to see the rain as an opportunity. Somebody say, the rain has to become an opportunity. Go to the next slide, please. The rain has to become an opportunity. Now, what do you see on the screen? Oh my God, oh my God. Somebody say, I'm not going to run from the rain. I'm going to run in the rain. Come on, come on. Somebody say, I'm going to run through the rain. Come on, y'all ain't acting like y'all mean it on tonight. Come on, go back to the other slide, Gary, because somebody's still stuck in a storm. Somebody still is stuck right here in the midst of your storm. This is why some of us as believers can't get out of where we're at, because we are only concentrating on the fact that it's raining. Forget the fact that it's raining and come up to a solution to be able to deal with your situation. Come up with a solution to be able to deal with the issue. If you go and you start seeking God in the middle of your storm, something great will begin to happen for you. When you start seeking God in the middle of the calamities of your life, something big will begin to happen. Go to the next slide back again, please. When you start seeing yourself in the midst of the rain. Now, do this dude look wet?
No.
He do not look wet. Why does he not look wet? Because he's prepared for the storm. He's prepared for the storm. He's not saying that the storm is going to overwhelm him. He's not saying that the storm is going to take him out. He is saying, I'm going to use the storm against the storm. I'm going to use the issues of that out in my life to turn around and help me to become what I'm supposed to become in my life. I'm going to use the pain and I'm going to turn the pain into power. I'm going to turn the pain into a praise. I'm going to turn it into something. Now, this man is running only because he is prepared for the storm. So how many of us have been running from our storms? Running from our storms. Running from our storms. Running from our storms. Running from our storms. But this man don't look like the storm is even sweating him. Matter of fact, he's sweating in the storm. Ain't that something? He ain't sweating from the storm. He's sweating in the storm. Because it looks to me like he is saying, the storm ain't going to stop me and prevent me from getting to my goal. Man, how many of us have pushed pause on our life because of storms? You push pause because of storms. But you can't push pause because of the storm. You can't see yourself. How many people have ever bought a raincoat? Ever bought a raincoat? You ever bought an umbrella? Because somebody said, there's money to be made from the storms that's coming. Ain't that something? Somebody said there's money to be made because of the storm that's coming. And they seized the opportunity in the moment. They didn't complain about the rain. They maximized on somebody else complaining about the rain. My God. My God. My God. Is anybody hear what I'm saying to you? That you got to start maximizing off of the misery. You got to start maximizing off of the misery. When you start maximizing off of the misery, you won't be afraid to go out in the middle of your storm. Matthew chapter 7 tells you that the person, when they believe, they start building. So when the storms of life come, when the winds of life come, their house won't fall. But when you're building on the sand, and the sand is, man, this is always wrong. Man, this is this. Man, this is that. Man, this is this thing. Man, this is that thing. That brings your attitude down. And if the only thing that you got in your attitude is to think about everything that's wrong, you will never get out. You will never find what's right. This is why people can run from church to church, because they're always looking at what's wrong. They're always looking at what ain't going on. They always got their mouth saying one thing. They always got their attitude saying another thing. They always got this thing and that thing going because they can't see themselves trying to build a raincoat. Another friend of mine, Apostle Marlon Hester, he wrote a song called Come On, Let's Dance in the Rain. He wrote a song saying, let's dance in the rain. Because he looks at the rain as an opportunity of regeneration. Ain't that something? When you can start looking at the rain things of your life as an opportunity of revival. Because as long as the rain don't come, drought is there. As long as the rain don't come, only cactuses and camels and stuff live in those type of elements. But I don't see nobody in here living in the desert. You got to start looking at the rain as the opportunity and saying, man, I'm not just going to stand here and cry because it's raining. If I'm called to exercise, rain ain't nothing but rain ain't nothing. I'm going to put on a bright color so I can be seen in the dark. Jesus. So I'm going to illuminate myself. What did Paul tell us here? Paul tells us here, he said that we are supposed to shine as lights in the world. But as long as you're complaining, you have turned down your bulb. As long as you're complaining, you have turned down your bulb.
As long as you are looking at the issue as something that is can't be fixed, that it can't be changed, it, you know, I got to keep on dealing with it. No. When you start allowing your mind to tap into the Holy Ghost, the next thing you know what will happen, that you will start seeing the light illuminating. And you ain't got no murmuring. You ain't got no disputing. You ain't got no arguing. You ain't got no fussing. You ain't got no cussing. You ain't got all of that. Why? Because you can see yourself getting past and rid of the complaining spirit. Somebody just touch your neighbor, look at your neighbor, and say, you're going to stop complaining to me. So I'm not done telling them to say my praise is going to drown out your complaint. Somebody say, my praise is going to make your complaint praise. Yes, my praise is going to become so powerful that it's going to drown out and it's going to make your complaining praise. Ooh, my God. My praise is going to drown out your complaining. Think about what that blind dude named Bartimaeus, and they told him to shut up. And the more they told him to shut up, what he do? The louder he got. Because he said, you know what? Forget this. The rain has come. The rain of blindness has been on my life long enough. So now I have regenerated my eyesight through the rain of my blindness. Go to the next slide, Reverend. Empty church. How many people complain about the church being empty? How many pastors are complaining about the church being empty? I can't preach to 10 people. I can't preach to 5 people. I can't preach to 3 people. I can't preach to 2 people. I can't preach to nobody. I can't do this. Well, you know, if there's nobody in the church, begin to pray. Begin to pray until somebody walks into the church. And then when somebody walks into the church, then you got somebody else that you got what they call a prayer partner. And that somebody else, and as they begin to pray together, and they begin to pray together, so 2 people began to pray, and then the next thing you know, 4 people are there, and now you got somebody that you can talk to. And now you got somebody that you can talk to. And now if you got somebody that you can talk to, the next thing you know that you got 5 or 10 people. And you got 10 people there. And now 10 people are on fire and excited. They ain't looking at the fact that they got 100 chairs. They looking at it as 10 of us in here together. And the person who started out with 0 is saying, man, God has multiplied me by 10. And when you start saying that God has multiplied me by 10, now my attitude has changed because I'm not looking at the 90 seats that are empty. I'm looking at the 10 people that have come, because when I walked in the door, there was nobody there. So when you start looking at your attitude, preachers, excuse me, pastors, when you start looking at it from the attitude and the perspective of saying, God, even if you send one other person to go along the journey with me, I'm going to go along the journey until you send somebody else. I'm going to continue to praise you, God. I'm not going to allow my sermons to be turned down. I'm not going to allow my attitude and my approach. I'm not going to turn off my prophetic gifting because there's not a room full of dollar bills. Oh, I'm sorry. There's not a room full of people. I'm not going to allow myself to let my apostolic flow stop flowing because of the fact that I only got a couple of people, a handful of people in the house. That does not matter. But what matters is that God called you to the place, and if he called you to the place, he called you to the place to turn the place upside down. Go to the next slide. Don't you understand that God is saying, if you can just begin to praise him where are you at, go back to the one on the slide before me one more time. When you can give God praise here, go back forward now. When you give God praise here, God will do it right there. Can somebody begin to praise him right now?
Hallelujah.
If you can, don't wait until this comes.
Yeah.
Preachers, don't wait until this comes to have to find your anointing.
All right.
If you got to find your anointing because of a crowd, you ain't got no anointing in the first place. If you got to drum up yourself because you got an engagement, you need to sit down and stay at home. If the only time you can pray is when you got to preach, then you're praying for the wrong reason. What we talked about a couple of weeks ago about Rachel that was doe-eyed or slant-eyed, right? Rachel continued to have babies for somebody who don't love her, and she gave him birth for the wrong reason, and she still was rejected. Oh my God, Leah was rejected because of the fact she was giving birth for the wrong reasons. She was giving birth for the wrong reason because she was trying to overcompensate. See, that's why some of us, when we get a little, when we got a little crowd sometimes, we overcompensate because we're trying to give birth for the wrong reason. But when God can use you in the bathroom preaching to yourself, you need to tell yourself, repent and be baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. You need to tell yourself, I will live and not die. You need to tell yourself that I will not be angry and bitter in that, and I will live a life full of forgiveness. I will tell myself that there by the grace of God go out. I will tell myself that his grace is sufficient for me. I ain't got to wait to tell you, and you. I need to start telling myself. Back before I was a pastor, back before I had a license, I was preaching in a Kmart aisle to myself. Understand. Because that's God's steps to get you to the place where you got to get to. But then go back one more time, please. If the only thing you see there is empty chairs, your vision is lost. If the only thing you see there is empty chairs, your vision is lost. Because if you look at the end, I see a door that's open. See, take your eyes off of what's not there. You said that and the open door presents a whole world of opportunity. Oh my God. The open door presents a whole world of opportunity for you. So why are you crying over, ain't nobody sitting here, ain't nobody sitting there? The open door says there's this potential that somebody can walk in that door at the appointed time. Don't the word of God tell us in 1 Corinthians about how Paul, he said that one was watering and then one was planting, mm-hmm. and God was doing what? Giving increase. So you never know. You never know. What Sunday somebody going to come in and say it's my time for increase. But if you ain't got the attitude and the winning attitude towards it and the approach towards it, you will always be looking at who ain't here. Somebody say, Lord, deliver me. From who ain't here, itis. Go to the next slide, Carrie. Go to the next slide. So again, now when the Lord blessed us to get right here, please don't start performing.
Hallelujah.
When the Lord blesses you, you all that's who may be watching this on the live stream, when the Lord blessed your church to get to this place that is full like that and overflowing and multiple service, please don't lose your mind. Because if you lose your mind because of that previous slide can't go back. God can't allow you to go right back there.
Come on, God.
All right.
Is that right, somebody?
Yes.
Somebody said we working on winning.
We working on winning.
Two slides up and we almost done. We about to get out of here. Y'all see this right here? Uh-huh. What do you see on the screen? What else do you see? Uh-huh. What else you see? So you say you got an empty stadium. You got chairs. You got a field. What else you see?
Players on the field. Oh,
somebody got some vision in here. Players are on the field. Then what happened here was there was an incident that happened in Baltimore. And when this happened in Baltimore, the White Sox were playing the Orioles. And they had to cancel the game because of the riots, because of one of those police involved shootings. So they had to shut down the city. But somebody said the game still goes on.
The game still goes on.
Oh my God. Even though some stuff may get shut down around you, there's still, the light is still moving in front of you. There are empty seats because they could not afford to let nobody in because they thought they were going to tear the stadium up. But they still said, we still got a game to play. We still got some things to do. So even though it seems like some people are shut out from you, you still got a job to do. Players are on the field. The man is at the plate, waiting for the pitch to be thrown. Where are you at? Do the guy that's at the plate, is he concerned about who's in the stands at this point?
No.
He ain't concerned about that. He's concerned about watching that ball
so he can try to hit the ball. And also watching the ball so that the ball don't hit him. As long as you're concerned about about who's around you, that makes you susceptible to any attack that can come in front of you. They're not concerned. They're only playing the game. They're concerned. Now, but if you can play here, next slide, Gary. Last slide, I believe. Lord knows you should be able to play here. You should be able to play in a full house. You should be able to go and be prepared, and this should not even overwhelm you. Somebody say, as a winner, I'm blocking out the crowd. Winners block out the crowd. Because we know that positive outcomes come even in negative situations. Positive outcomes can come in negative situations. Philippians 4:11-12 says, not that I speak in respect of want, for I have learned in whatsoever state I'm in, therewith to be content. I know both how to be abased, and I know how to abound. Everywhere, in all things, I am instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. But I've learned how to be content. Because positive outcomes can come in negative situations. It's just simple as this. Look at what you have while you are in it so that you can survive it. What do you have while you're in it? If you look at what you have while you're in it, the next thing you know, you'll be able to survive it. You'll be able to survive it. Somebody say, I'm going to survive it. You'll survive it. You'll survive it. Go back to the guy with the running, that's running. You're not running from your storm. Leave it right there. Everyone's standing on your feet. Keep it going. You are not running from your storm. You're running in your storm. You're running in your storm, not from your storm. You're being built in the moment of adversity. Adversity is building us right now. The adversities that you may be facing that you feel like are just flooding you, God is saying, I'm building you in it. Look at what you got. Somebody said, I'm gonna get a needle and some thread. I'm gonna find something that the rain repels off of, so that whatever I got on underneath me will be protected. Oh my God. If you can allow the Holy Spirit to be knitted over your life, your heart will be protected in the storms of life. If you can just find yourself in a place of worship, a place of prayer, a place of praise, not a place of complaint, not a place of murmuring, not a place of feeling like you're not going to be able to cope with it. Whatever your it is, you can make it. Whatever your end is, you can deal with it. You can tolerate it. You can live through it. God will allow you to live through it. Somebody say, I'm going to live through it. You're going to live through it. Living through it. Not saying that the storm it's just going to drown me. No, that's not what it's about. This is about you living in the moment of your adversity and watching God do the rest. Lift your hands before the Lord. Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, I pray for these your people tonight, God. Lord, those who are in this sanctuary, those who are watching us, God, those who will watch us even later, God, that you, God, will meet them in the middle of their pain. You will meet them in the middle of their storm, and they will begin to not run from the storm. But God, they will look at what they have while they're in the middle of the storm, and they will begin to see themselves as victorious over the storm. Why? Not because it stopped raining, but because you, God, have equipped them to be able to train in the midst of. You've equipped them to find you in the middle of the worst moments of their life, and the pain and the adversity and the struggles that they are in, and the issues that are trying to deluge them. But God, they are finding you in the storm. They're finding their hope. They're finding their vision. They're finding their purpose. They're finding their power. They're finding their ministry. They're finding the renewal and the revival. They're finding the resurrection in the middle of the storm. They're not desert babies. But God, they are people who are moving and winning in the storms. So God, we thank you tonight. We bless you tonight for the rain gear. We bless you for the attitude adjustment and the shift, that our mouth would not curse what you are trying to get us to grow in, that our minds would not be so beat down that we cannot even conceptualize what is about to happen in our life. And even as you had David in the middle of that wilderness, tending to those sheep until his name was called, we're saying, God, we will win where we're at until our name is called to our next. We will win where we're at until our name is called into our next. And we bless you for it tonight. We honor you for it tonight. We give you glory for it tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Somebody give God a great praise tonight and just begin to praise him. Come on, open up your mouth and begin to bless him. Begin to bless him for you being a winner. Begin